people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with India, that has launched the biggest vaccination drive in the world. India claims that it has developed the most cost-effective vaccines under the sun, which will be instrumental in eradicating the deadly disease. New Delhi has approved two vaccines and aims to inoculate as many as 300 million citizens in the next 5 to 6 months. India has also said that it is committed to helping its neighbors that are dependent and are waiting for others' progress.
India, the first country in South Asia to launch a vaccination drive, and not one, but with two vaccines, is pursuing a countrywide mission at war footing that aims to inoculate first 30 million prioritized citizens in a few weeks. First to get the vaccine will be 30 million health and other frontline workers, followed by about 270 million older than 50 or deemed high risk. Earlier this month, the country's drug regulator had cleared AstraZeneca's locally branded Covishield, an indigenous Covaxin developed by Bharat Biotech and Government Institute. The country is also working at developing other vaccines that are at the different trial stages. The government has already bought 11 million doses of the Covishield shot and 5.5 million of Covaxin. Prime Minister Narendra Modi, who has lauded the efforts of all those who have been involved in the entire exercise of developing the vaccine, acknowledged that India had a far bigger challenge in comparison with other countries.
दुनिया के 50 देशों में 3-4 सप्ताह से वैक्सीनेशन का काम चल रहा है, करीब करीब एक महीना हुआ, लेकिन अब भी करीब करीब 2.5 करोड़ लोग ही वैक्सीन हो पाई है पूरी दुनिया में। उनकी अपनी तैयारियां हैं, उनका अपना अनुभव है, उनका सामर्थ्य है, वो अपने तरीके से कर रहे हैं। लेकिन अब भारत में हमें अगले कुछ महीनों में ही लगभग 30 करोड़ आबादी के टीकाकरण का लक्ष्य हासिल करना है। इस चुनौती का पूर्वानुमान लगाते हुए ही बीते महीनों में भारत ने बहुत व्यापक तैयारियां की।
The observers have time and again said that Indian role in immunizing the world is going to be the most important, as the country has a legacy of providing safe and cheaper medicines, and a vaccine with only those attributes can ensure an immune world, including some poor Asian and African countries. Even in the COVID-19 vaccines, the price difference between those of India and others is expectedly significant. While the cost of the vaccine has been kept as low as $3 in India, the United States and European Union are paying much higher prices for one dose. The owner of the Serum Institute of India, the largest vaccine producer by volume in the world, says that lower prices of vaccines will help pace up an effective fight against the virus. However, he intends to sell it at a higher price in the private market.
So we've given a special price of 200 rupees for the first 100 million doses only to the government of India. On their request that we want to support the aam aadmi, the poor, the vulnerable, the healthcare workers and all of that, and after that We will be selling it at 1,000 rupees in the private markets. And of course, to the government of India, we'll still maintain a very reasonable price, but it'll be a little bit more than 200 rupees, which is our cost price.
India's eastern neighbors, Bangladesh too, will be getting Covishield vaccine dose at an affordable $4. India says it has already started receiving vaccine orders, but will take a call on export only after a few weeks. Apart from Bangladesh, India is expected to provide vaccine support to Nepal, Bhutan, Sri Lanka, among other South Asian nations. It will be exporting vaccines to the rest of the world in subsequent stages. Meanwhile, the positivity rate has been encouraging for the people and the administration as the country has been recording a consistently low number of cases. The government says it has been able to flatten the curve owing to sustained restrictions with citizens' continued support. While the mortality rate of India was always amongst the lowest, its low infection rate has provided it a shot in the arm against the disease. However, if Prime Minister Modi's cautionary words are to be followed, there cannot be any carelessness until all are vaccinated.
Moving on, a massive fire broke out in the Rohingya refugees' camps in Bangladesh's Cox's Bazar, destroying homes of thousands. UNHCR, the refugee agency of the United Nations, said that more than 550 shelters belonging to around 3,500 people were completely or partially destroyed in the blaze. The camp is home to over 1 million of Rohingya refugees who fled a military-led crackdown in 2017 and have been living in overcrowded camps. The Bangladesh government has relocated a few hundreds of them, but that hasn't changed the density substantially.
A huge fire swept through the Rohingya refugee camps in southern Bangladesh in the early hours of Thursday, destroying homes belonging to thousands of people. The UN Refugee Agency, UNHCR, which has been looking after around 1 million of these refugees for past 3 years, said more than 550 shelters home to around 3,500 people were either totally or partially destroyed in the blaze. 150 shops were also reported destroyed. Authorities and natives are content at the news that no casualties have been reported thus far. Families, including children, could be seen sifting through charred, corrugated iron sheets to see if they could salvage anything from their still smoldering homes. But little remained of the camp, which had stood for decades, aside from concrete poles and the husk of a few trees. While observers say that Rohingya have come to terms with periodically springing small or big disasters, a fire of such magnitude is a challenge they have never endured. More than 1 million of them live in the mainland camps in southern Bangladesh, the vast majority which fled Myanmar after the security forces launched a crackdown on those attacking their posts. UN investigators said it was executed with genocidal intent, a charge that Myanmar has denied. Fire is not the first crisis for refugees. Several repatriation attempts have failed in the past and they have been forced to live in abject poverty, with no light at the end of the tunnel. According to various human rights organizations and the United Nations itself, they are also being subjected to forced relocation. The process of shifting them to low-lying island of Bhasanchar in the Bay of Bengal has continued despite opposition. Bangladesh has, however, defended its decision, saying it wants to relocate 100,000 Rohingya to the remote island to decongest the refugee camps, which shelter approximately 1 million Rohingya. Housing blocks have been set up for them, and the government claims the new blocks will be equipped with all facilities to improve their living standards, thereby improving their future. The United Nations says it has not been involved in the relocation, but urged the government to ensure no refugee is forced to move to Bhasanchar Island, which only emerged from the sea 20 years ago. It is not clear whether their request has been considered or not, but Rohingya continue to reel under multi-pronged plights which do not appear to be going away in immediate future.
Moving on. The Himalayan nation of Nepal has plunged into a deep political crisis with the dissolution of its parliament by Prime Minister K.P. Sharma Oli. And the impasse is not getting resolved, with both opposing sides adamant on their stand. While the Dahal faction, which was to lead the country after half mark into the five-year term, has been demanding restoration of parliament through the Supreme Court, Oli is bent at having snap elections in April and May. Kathmandu is also facing a stiff resistance from common people as an intensified demand to bring back monarchy has sprung up. And after a growing suspicion on Chinese role in the Nepalese affairs, New Delhi appears to be the only and final option that can placate the warring sides.
Clashes broke out between the common people and the police after the former carried out a march in support of the return of constitutional monarchy on the occasion of birth anniversary of King Prithvi Narayan Shah. While the protesters said the government has grown wary of the rising demands of monarchy, Kathmandu called it a law and order situation. The Oli-led administration, which has been at the helm of a caretaker government in the country, is accused of intimidation, suppression of dissent, and curbing of freedom of expression. Some even say it has launched a crackdown on leaders of opposing ideologies.
किन भन्दाखेरि विगतमा पनि हामीले गरेका थियौँ पहिला पनि पोहोर पनि गऱ्यौँ पहिला पनि गऱ्यौँ हामीले दुई चार वर्षै भयो जुन बेला चाहिँ यहाँका चाहिँ राष्ट्रका घातीहरू चाहिँ पृथ्वीनारायण शाहको शारीरिकलाई थुकेर हिँड्थे त्यतिखेर हामी राजावादी कङ्ग्रेस नेपाली कङ्ग्रेस पिपी भएको कारणले गर्दाखेरि हामी चाहिँ माल्यार्पण गर्थ्यौँ तर अहिले यो सत्तामा बस्नेहरू हाम्रो जनमानस ठुलो भयो त्यस पछाडि डराएर हामीलाई चाहिँ रोकेको हो त्यो कुरा हामी प्रश्न गर्न चाहन्छौँ.
Nepal is undergoing a political crisis after Prime Minister K.P. Sharma Oli decided he could no longer work with rival factions within his Nepal Communist Party, which was formed in 2018 to unite the Marxist-Leninist and main Maoist parties following their success in elections in late 2017. With 2 years of his term to run, Oli dissolved Pratinidhi Sabha or lower house of the parliament in December and called for fresh elections. Shock, anger, demonstrations followed. As many as seven ministers owing allegiance to the anti-Oli faction of the NCP resigned. The supporters of Prachanda and Nepal took to the streets protesting against Oli's move, which has been challenged in the country's Supreme Court. People of the country who have already been hit by the pandemic are increasingly disillusioned and say they want a system they can sustain and not which can be overturned by a whimsical leader.
प्रधानमन्त्री केपी शर्मा ओलीबाट जुन चाहिँ असंवैधानिक जुन संविधानमै नलेखेको कुरा चाहिँ संसद विघटन जस्तो एउटा जघन्य आपराधिक जुन कदम चालियो त्यसका विरुद्ध आज हाम्रो संगठन अनेरा सहयोग चाहिँ आन्दोलनमा चाहिँ चरणबद्ध आन्दोलन दोस्रो चरणको आन्दोलनमा गइरहेको छ.
The issue is now with the Supreme Court of Nepal. But there too, the warring sides have been demanding a different type of bench to hear the case. However, in such a scenario, observers are wondering if New Delhi could play a role. The permanent ally and all-weather friend of Nepal has provided it with all forms of support in the past as well. They say the 6th India-Nepal Joint Commission meeting, where the leaders review gamut of the bilateral partnership, might focus on restoring peace in the Himalayan region. Some experts have even said that New Delhi, which has always had positive intents and plans for Nepal, can help it in such a crisis. According to them, both should be working together for a peaceful and prosperous Nepal.
Moving on. While a systematic discrimination against Shias in Pakistan and illegally occupied regions of POK and Gilgit-Baltistan is known to all, the horrific incident of brutal killing of 11 coal miners in Balochistan has shaken the conscience of people and observers around the territories. People in Gilgit and Muzaffarabad held demonstrations to condemn the Pakistan establishment, which they say has either been complicit or culpable in the systematic killings of Shias across the length and breadth of region under Pakistan's control.
These people holding banners demanding justice are the most discriminated people under Pakistan's illegal control. Shia, an Islamic denomination which finds itself in minority, has been systematically targeted over the years by invaders, Sunni fundamentalists, and now the Pakistani establishment. The recent killing of 11 Hazara coal miners was the recent chapter in their systematic elimination. People in Muzaffarabad say they have been unable to come to terms with the extrajudicial killings of Shias that are tacitly supported by Islamabad.
कि हमेशा आप हमें टारगेट करते हो, हमेशा हमारे लोगों का कत्ल करते हो.
ये वो कौम नहीं है कि जो बम साथ बांध के इदारों के दफ्तरों में घुसती है और पाकिस्तान के जवानों को शहीद करती है. ये बहुत पुरअमन कौम है. इस कौम का इतना ख्याल कीजिए कि इसको बिला वजह मरने से बचाइए, इनके गले काटने का मामला बंद करवाइए. आपके हाथ में है सब कुछ, आपके अख्तियार में है सब कुछ.
Another region under Pakistan's illegal occupation, Gilgit-Baltistan, which was once dominated by Shia population, has met an even brutal assault on their ethnicity and identity. Locals say Islamabad has been systematically altering their demography in the region. Their claims have been supported by extensive research work carried out by a number of organizations. In a recent study conducted by the Law and Society Alliance, a think tank, the population of Gilgit-Baltistan is now approximately 1.5 million, with around 39% Shia, 27% Sunni, 18% Ismaili, and 16% Nurbakshi. Shia
Shia in Gilgit-Baltistan constituted more than 80% of population in 1948.
आज नहीं बल्कि 2013 से अब तक मुसलसल वहाँ के जो हज़ारा बरदरी है जो शिया कम्युनिटी से ताल्लुक़ रखते हैं उनकी नस्ल कुशी हो रही है।
ये जो वाक़या बलूचिस्तान मश के मकाम पर हुआ है इंतहाई दिलसोस दिलखराश और इंतहाई जुल्म बरबरीत का जो तारीख़ रकम हुआ है कि 11 नहते पुरामन मासूम कानकुन जो अपने घर के अफराद की किफालत के लिए मजदूरी में मशगूल थे उनका न किसी सियासत से ताल्लुक़ था न किसी पार्टी से न किसी ऐसे मामले से जिससे इलाके के माहौल को अमन को नुकसान या ख़तरा पहुँचता। उन लोगों को इस कदर सफाकाना ज़ालिमाना अंदाज में कत्ल करके उनको ज़बह करके उनके साथ जुल्म करना ये इंसानियत के मुँह पर तमांचा है।
The locals have agitated, protested, and frequently raised demands seeking constitutional and political rights. Their demands, however, have been muzzled with brute force. Voices for rights in Gilgit-Baltistan are suppressed by law enforcement agencies, and the nationalist leaders are subjected to torture and imprisonment. In order to tighten its grip on the region, Islamabad has arbitrarily decided to give it a provisional status of a province. Observers say this might be the beginning of the end of Gilgit-Baltistan and its people.
India is the birthplace of Buddhism, and every Buddhist festival is celebrated with great fervor and splendor across the country. The monastic festivals held in the holy city of Bodh Gaya are brilliant shows of song, dance and colour that revitalize the spirit of the people. So this week in our cultural lineup, we'll show you how Bhutanese monks are performing traditional mask dance or charm dance for the peace and harmony of the country.
Buddhist scriptures describe Bodh Gaya as the navel of the earth, and millions of pilgrims and tourists visit every year, backing the holy town and Mahabodhi temple, Buddhism's holiest shrine. The environment in Royal Bhutan Monastery was convivial as the Buddhist monks from Bhutan recently participated in a traditional cultural mask dance to ward off evil spirits. Donned in gaily painted masks, ceremonial swords and sparkling jewels, Buddhist monks leaped and swung to the rhythm of resounding drums and chanting of monks. Monks from various parts of the country participated in this traditional dance, which is commonly known as charm. This vibrant and enlivening dance is the traditional dance of Bhutan, usually performed during Setus, the annual Bhutanese festival.
ये डांस करता है ना, ये लोग सब भगवान का अवतार लोग है ना, भगवान का अवतार लोग है। इस जगह में जहाँ भी हम लोग रहता है उसमें हम लोग का ऐसे भूत प्रीत बहुत है ना, हम लोग का अशांति करने वाला। तो ये लोग ऐसे डांस करेगा तो ये भूत प्रीत लोग थोड़ा शांति हो जाएगा ना, तो शांति होगा तो हम लोग को शांति होगा तो दूसरा को शांति देने हम लोग का सकेगा ना। हम लोग खुद शांति नहीं तो दूसरा को हम लोग शांति करने के नहीं सकेगा ना।
According to Buddhism, charm dance is considered a form of meditation and an offering prayer to the gods and goddesses. And it is believed that dancing lamas perform a play depicting the triumph of good over evil through their rhythmic movements. It is also performed in various Buddhist festivals like Losar Festival, Spituk Gostar, Lumbini Festival, Ulamba Festival, Mag Puja Day and Hemis Festival. Every year, Buddhist devotees from different countries gather to witness the traditional dance. However, This year, due to pandemic, the ritual was scaled down and performed without any spectators.
कोरोना से बजे से हम लोग कोई भी अंदर आने नहीं दिया ये हम लोग इंडोर करता है
Such types of events represent a rich culture and traditional heritage of holy city Bodh Gaya and gives a gigantic experience of pure country life away from the hustle and bustle of the city.
Indian culture, they say, is an amalgamation of a wide array of unique norms and traditions. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.